Recently, U.S. warships ignore the Chinese regime's maritime traffic safety law and frequently appear in the South China Sea, despite protests by Beijing. In retaliation, Chinese submarines and destroyers pass the exclusive economic zone near the Aleutian Islands and appear near Alaska from August 30th to September 1. 1 week later, Joe Biden and Xi Jinping had their second phone conversation since Biden took office. Are the United States and China escalating their military confrontation? So what did Biden and Xi talk about? Hello everyone, I'm Lei. Welcome to Lei's Real Talk. After 7 months and having clashed over Taiwan, Hong Kong, Xinjiang, technology, and the origin of coronavirus, the two leaders spoke for 90 minutes on September the 9th. The call took place at a time when both were under mounting internal and external pressures. For Biden, the southern border crisis, inflation, and the resurgence of COVID are just a few domestic issues haunting him, along with the recent debacle in Afghanistan, which has seriously affected his credibility and tanked his support. Xi Jinping's situation is even worse. He cannot extricate himself from the problems of worsening international relations, a deteriorating domestic economy, the pandemic, and escalating internal political infighting. He has not left China for over 600 days, and his lack of foreign visits has broken the record for all heads of state in G20 nations. But Biden's phone call gave Xi some relief. After all, it was Biden who initiated the call, and it saved Xi's face. Just like the state media proclaimed, Xi scored a point by having the Americans back down to compromise. Xi couldn't hide his sense of relief when he quoted a classic Chinese poem. In the dark mist of bewilderment with no clear path, a sudden glimpse of hope appears behind the shady willow trees. The Chinese regime has sensed that the Biden team is strong on diplomacy and weak on military operations, and that the administration doesn't want to go to war with China. And maybe that's why Xi Jinping felt relieved and recited the poem. In fact, not going to war with China is a view that's strongly held by the Biden administration. The recent controversial phone calls General Mark Milley made to his Chinese counterpart is the perfect example. The core of this controversy is that Milley secretly assured Chinese PLA General Li Zuochen that the U.S. would not launch war against China, and if it did, he would personally inform Li first. Milley defended himself by saying that it's his responsibility to ensure stability. Biden also defended him. Milley isn't alone. 2 days before his controversy broke out, on September the 13th, his deputy, General John E. Hyten, who is the vice chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, made it clear in a video conversation with the Brookings Institute that the United States should never go to war with China. Take a look.
So when you look at great powers, our goal should be to never go to war with China, to never go to war with Russia, because though that day is a horrible day for the planet, a horrible day for our countries, it wrecks the world, it wrecks the world's economy, it's bad for everybody. So we have to make sure we don't go down that path. We've had pretty good success with the Soviet Union and now Russia. We're having strategic stability talks with Russia to make sure we understand where we are, not just in the nuclear realm, but in space as well. We need to have that conversation start with the Chinese. We really do. We need to be able to sit down. I need to be able to sit down. General Milley needs to be able to sit down. Secretary Austin, the political leadership, the State Department, and talk about these issues with China. Because as different as we are, we do have a fundamental common goal, and that is to never go to war with each other. Because war with a nuclear power is a bad thing.
Both leaders issued a statement after the call. The statement from the White House was very brief, with only 5 sentences. According to the Chinese statement, Joe Biden said that the two countries have no reason to go from being competitive to confrontational, and that the U.S. has no intention of changing the One China policy. But this statement made the Taiwanese government nervous. The Taiwan Foreign Ministry issued a statement saying that it's closely monitoring the interactions between China and the U.S., and that the Ministry of Foreign Affairs will obtain regular briefings to ensure that the United States-Taiwan policy remains unchanged. In an effort to clarify the matter, some Biden officials pointed out to media that the White House statement didn't use the word China, but instead used PRC, or People's Republic of China. Taiwan is certainly not part of the PRC. This issue of semantics has held the US-One-China policy in place. The day after the Biden-Xi call, the Financial Times had an exclusive report that the White House was considering Taiwan's request to rename its Washington office from the Taipei Representative Office to the Taiwan Representative Office. This report was to ease the widespread concern that the United States might be backing down on its support of Taiwan. And another announcement came after the Biden-Xi phone call. This one was about the investigation into Beijing's practice of using industrial subsidies to give Chinese companies an unfair edge over foreign competitors. It's called the 301 investigation because it's under Section 301 of the U.S. trade law. The last time the U.S. government launched this investigation was under the Trump administration, and it ultimately led to the trade war with China. The Biden administration's China strategy is to contain Beijing through diplomatic maneuvers and to build strong strategic alliances. Last Wednesday, on September the 15th, Biden announced with British Prime Minister Boris Johnson and Australian Prime Minister Scott Morrison that a trilateral security partnership called AUKUS to strengthen mutual security and defense cooperation was established. AUKUS stands for Australia, UK, and the US. This partnership is to help Australia obtain nuclear-powered submarines to enhance the security of the Indo-Pacific region. The collaboration will also focus on cyber capabilities, artificial intelligence, quantum technologies, and additional undersea capabilities. Even though the official statement didn't mention China, this new alliance obviously is aimed at addressing the threat posed by the Chinese communist regime. I noticed that for both the Taiwan Representative Office name change and the 301 investigation, the media used the word considering to describe Biden's plan. So we don't know if his administration will follow up with real action or is just considering action. So will these measures be enough to contain Beijing? Maybe for now. I think Xi won't go to war before Beijing Winter Olympic Games in February 2022. Nor does he want any drama before securing his third term at the 20th People's Congress next fall. But it's hard to say what will happen after that. So for now, we'll continue to see Biden and Xi put on a straight face to play tough with each other, since of course the show must go on. Please subscribe to my channel and help share my videos, and I thank you.